We're thrilled, pleased, delighted to have Ron Suskind here with us tonight. Ron is a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist and an author of many important works of nonfiction. These books have helped shape the national debates and explored complexities of human experiences. Ron's latest work in the book he will be discussing tonight is Life Animated, as you know, a story of sidekicks, heroes, and autism, which chronicles his family's 20-year journey with his youngest son, Owen's autism. The book is similar in style to Ron's first book, A Hope in the Unseen, which was done in 1988. And that book explored the world of an honors student at Washington, D.C.'s most crime-ridden inner-city school, and Cedric, the young man who starts out in high school, his journey to Brown University. And that book, I think, changed the way people thought about education, the way they thought about inner-city education, the fact that we think that it's easy once somebody gets into Brown, they've made it, but the struggle that continues about race and class and achievement. Ron's other works include the New York Times bestseller Confidence Men, which was done in September 2011 about the fall of the U.S. economy and the presidency of Barack Obama, The Way of the World in August 2008 about the forces fighting for the global hearts and minds at a time when fiercely destructive weapons are available to the common man. And then The 1% Doctrine was in June 2006, how the U.S. government frantically improvised to fight a new kind of war on terrorism after 9/11. And The Price of Loyalty, George W. Bush, the White House, and the education of Paul O'Neill. So Mr. Suskind was the Wall Street Journal's senior national affairs reporter from 1993 until his departure in 2000. He won the Pulitzer in 1995 for feature writing. As I said, he lives in Cambridge, but he used to live in Washington, D.C., where his older son, Walter, was a classmate of Eben, who's here. And Ron gave Eben and Walter's commencement address at their high school. And so in our house, whenever we go to a commencement, we always ask, was it as good as Ron's? And it never is, or was. So he set this standard. It's like a Suskind graduation speech is the finest you can give. So with that, I will turn it over to Ron.
I'll just take the mic and I'll just kind of walk around.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you want to take it, take it.
Is it, which is the longest cord? Is that the best cord? Okay. Yeah, and I might come back over here. Okay, oh, it's working, oh gosh. Feelings, nothing, okay, just, yeah. Thank you. Sue Ellen, thank you. I love Sue Ellen. I've known Sue Ellen and the Lazarus Eam clan for many years. As she said, we're Sidwellians in Washington. Eben and Walter were classmates. That graduation speech, I mean, really the only, my measure of success is that There were several members from the Bush administration in the audience, and one of them said, "Not bad, not too bad." I mean, I was over the moon. I lived on it for years. Sue Ellen says, "I consented to come to the Vineyard. It was, of course, informed consent. I needed little encouragement. I love coming here. Any excuse will do. I've been out here for a lot of the books." And, you know, this is a sunlit uplands. What can I tell you? It's, if I could create a nation of this, I mean, just imagine. I mean, just imagine the number of NPR listeners we'd have at that point. Okay, so now this book, which is kind of interesting for anyone who's read any of the other books, is kind of the book behind all the other books. So, and I write this out in Life Animated. You know, as journalists, we seem to be very public. And I think, you know, my buddies, Tony and Geraldine, who was with the Wall Street Journal, we all were together there. I mean, I think they might attest to this, is that we are very public, but we often are quite reserved about us. You know, we have kind of a face we offer, you know, that, you know, with a pad, you know, searching for truth. But we often don't turn the lens on ourselves. I'm here, I'm objective. I'm here to ask the questions, not to be asked the questions. And that's the way I lived a good bit of my life. You know, and all of those books, the other five books, were driven by things that I began to acknowledge, but would not speak of for the most part in public. You know, no one really knew about our life, our real life, our life in the house. We kept it private, Cornelia and I, and Walter and Owen, for the most part. And now we're outed. And it feels fine. You know, Cornelia was so excited she even bought me this new blazer, you know. Be out there. So I'm going to tell the story of what occurs, because it's a story of not just our protagonist, Owen, my son, but it's really a story of a family. And the family, us, you know, starts in one world, a world that is familiar to, I think, many of the folks here, and of course is the world in which I rise and live and breathe. And then it changed. And when I think of that earlier life, that first life, you know, I can feel it quite vividly even now. I don't miss it, but I can see those people. And those people left Boston in 1993, a young family on the make, on the move. I left the Wall Street Journal Bureau here, and I was going to Washington in a kind of, you know, lovely effusion of young professional vigor. Young family, Cornelia and I, Walter is 5 at that point, Owen is 2.5, and I've got this job as the senior national affairs writer for the Wall Street Journal, which is a job, you know, you have to kill people to get. And I killed 10 people for the job. Family men, nice guys mostly. And so there we are going to Washington in a great surf of optimism and faith in possibility, I suppose. And we move to Georgetown, we rent a house, and there are boxes to unpack, and I'm in a new bureau and trying to find, you know, my desk in the bathroom, and something's not right with Owen. Now, initially, we weren't sure what we're looking at. You know, leaving Boston, he was a typical 2.5-year-old, a brilliant, playful, the few hundred word 2.5-year-old vocabulary. You know, I love you, let's get ice cream, where are my Ninja Turtles, the basic array. And all of a sudden, he's not saying very much. And then he's not making eye contact. And then he's saying less. And then he's very upset. He's uncomfortable. He's crying a lot. He was a very kind of placid, happy kid. And he's none of that. And Cornelia and I start to talk. Every night I get home, she's like, today I need to tell you something. I'm like, all right, what? It's almost like, you know, let's talk about movies or something. I don't want to hear it. Well, he doesn't seem to be able to use a cup now. He's using this sippy cup. I'm like, the sippy cup? He graduated to the big boys cup 1.5 years ago. And then after 3 months, he was down to one word, juice. Single word. But he didn't seem to want juice. We give him the sippy cup, he refused it. I'd say, honey, this doesn't make sense. You know, people don't grow backwards. We started to think about it like a kidnapping, looking for clues to a kidnapping. What could have happened? I mean, could he have been struck in the head when we weren't looking, banged his head? Who can say? Could he have ingested something toxic? few months pass, and we sit with the first specialist. We first went to a pediatrician who said, you need to see someone with more expertise. And then we saw her, a specialist, who first uses the word autism. Now, the people sitting in the chairs, me and Cornelia, they're quite vivid in my mind's eye. Because we floated above them. You could feel yourself lifting out of your body when the doctor says this. You can see them looking down, the two of them frozen. Autism. What do we know in 1994? We know Rain Man. That's all mostly anyone knows. Now everyone knows. And that's public education, which is important. Make no mistake. But back then, we're saying, Raymond Babbitt, I'm a good driver, Dustin Hoffman, our kid? That can't be. So we responded in all of the natural ways. Denial. You know, denial, a psychiatrist friend of mine, an old wise psychiatrist said to me years later, he says, he's a Cuban Jew. So he says, I love this guy, Max Plotsky. Run. Denial. Respect denial. It's a very powerful force. It's what we do when we cannot cope with what life offers us. Okay? I didn't respect denial. I didn't even recognize denial. What we did do, though, was this doctor, who was, I'm sure, a very lovely woman, we had to immediately demonize her. We called her the Ice Queen. That was, you know, like a touch of ice, frozen. Oh, God, we went after her, I mean, you know, every night. How could she? What kind of a doctor is she anyway? Check her credentials. But after a few months, we don't need a doctor. He's gone. He's sitting there, but he's not with us. And he's not speaking. What is he doing? Well, one thing he does has an echo from before the onset of the autism. Back then, he and his brother, being of this age, were big fans of some big movies. Now, you know this age, and I'm seeing some young people about in their early, mid-20s. 1989 is The Little Mermaid. Anyone want to see The Little Mermaid here? Let's see a show of hands. Yeah, there you go. I can tell, yeah. Yeah. Some Ariel. Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, I'm seeing Ariel. I'm just looking at you. They love that movie. They love Beauty and the Beast, which is a great movie. Aladdin. They loved them. My God, the kids loved them. They watched them. They sang the songs. We sang the songs together. Now, though, Owen is watching these movies with peculiar intensity. This is the only thing that seems to give him comfort. He goes up to our bedroom on the third floor of the house in Georgetown. He, you know, his motor function is shot. I mean, he's spilling the cup. He's moving around like someone walking with their eyes shut. One motor function is working. The remote control, the thumb on rewind. He watches, he rewinds. Joyously, eyes lit up. Okay, so this is what we can do together. We can watch The Little Mermaid. So that's what we do, the four of us, on a big bed. Whole family, big bed, Little Mermaid. Now at this point, Owen is murmuring gibberish. Gibberish like little babies do. You know, we can't make sense of it. He's saying, juicer vos. We think he wants more juice. We give him the sippy cup. Doesn't want the juice. But he's rewinding on a rainy afternoon, about a year into silence. He's rewinding a part of The Little Mermaid, where Ariel, the protagonist, must pay a price for transformation, to become human. And Sea Witch, Ursula, Pat Carroll, says, it won't cost you much, a trifle, really. Just your voice. Rewind. Walter's like, oh, and just play the movie. Stop rewinding. Rewind. I'm chatting with Cornelia. We're not even listening. And all of a sudden, she goes, it's not juice. I said, well, it's not juice. It's just. just your voice. I grab Owen, just your voice. And he looks at me for the first time in a year and goes, juicer rose, juicer rose, juicer rose. We start dancing around the room. Walter's saying, Owen's talking again. We're jumping on the bed. This we called our Annie Sullivan, Helen Keller moment in a water. And then we see our doctors, who already we have found some we like, you know, and they're helping us raise our son, and they are heroes already in our family. And we sit down with one of them, Alan Rosenblatt, and he's like, okay, let me explain. This is called echolalia. And I'm like, oh God, I don't like the sound of that term. He's like, yes, I like a parrot. Yeah, kind of. You say, you're a very nice and pretty girl. And she says back, pretty girl. So, oh gosh. So we're here between Helen Keller and a pet shop. He's like, kinda. Which is it? Mostly they don't understand what the sounds mean. This goes on for years. The next phrase a year later is booty lies witten. Booty lies witten. Any deciphering of booty lies witten? Beauty lies. There you go. Beauty lies within. So then we say back to the doctor, okay, if it's just noise to him, what are the odds he's picking those three words out of 89 minutes of noise? They seem to be thematically sensible to me. Who can say? So we begin the passage of years and really the life that we're living now in a way. We're living at this point very much in moment, in the moment, because we can't really think about the future in all the ways you tend to. There's a moment that I write about in the book which is vivid, because it was a moment where I could see myself. And it was when Owen's at his first school, right around the time where he's doing juicer vos. And it's a school for kids with significant special needs. So we're in his first real classroom. He's 4 years old. And there's just three kids in the classroom. There are two autistic spectrum kids and one Down syndrome kid. And just the three of them and two teachers, and we're observing, sitting on this little mat with our backs against the wall, Cornelia and I. And at that point, we start to inch out beyond the house. And the two spectrum kids are spinning and gone. The Down syndrome kid is pretty attentive, actually. He's kind of doing what the teachers are asking. And we just sat there. And I began to think, sitting on the mat with my back against the cinder blocks, cross-legged on the floor, I began to think about these ideas, these notions, these dreams, these wonderments we all carry about our children, unrecognized. Two boys, that would mean two presidents after they won the Nobel Prize. Now, one's going to be an Olympic athlete, so that's going to be more complicated. You know, prima ballerinas after she sells her internet company. I mean, we walk around with quite a load. And I began to think about, what is the traditional allotment? I never even recognized these wild-eyed notions. But if you want to know the allotment, I can tell you. If you have to, you pull them out one by one and smash them in the corner, it's a pretty high pile. Because that's what I'm doing in that classroom. And I thought about a bus I saw as a kid, the short bus that Adam Sandler and other people make fun of, and the Downs kids. They were a free kick. They didn't even know you were making fun of them, right? As I'm thinking back on this person and his life, I look up and the kid, is just the Downs kid, Eric, is looking right at me. Now, I'm sitting down, and he's only this tall, so we're eye to eye. And he looks at me, and he looks at Cornelia, and he looks back at me, and he can see that we are miserable. Now, I don't know this about Downs kids, because I don't know any. They're finely tuned sensory equipment. They're often high, peaked emotional acuity. I know that now. I didn't know it then. And so he looks at me and he looks at Cornelia and then he hugs me and says, I love you. I don't even know if he hugged Cornelia because I was spinning upside down at that point. I was learning against my will, against what my mother, bless her, had taught me. She's this little woman from Brooklyn. I can just sense that there are other mothers like this who may have inhabited this room. She basically laid it out for me early, not in so many words, but sort of. I won't love you any less if you're not a success. I just won't mention your name to other people, just so you know that. It's called the motivational advantages of conditional affection. Win first, I will love you that much more. This is reality. It's not just from Brooklyn, though that is clearly an R&D lab for this sort of thinking. And so I've been racing forward for many years based on both her notions and those of a person not in the room with me, my father, who was a little different. He was a country Jew from upstate New York with, let's say, deficits of ambition until he met my mother, who died when I was about 14. When I was 14, he got sick when I was 13. And he writes a letter to my brother and I about living the worthwhile life that is given to us posthumously. So here we've got these two people. He says something in the letter. Let me just say it because it's really lovely. He says, now, you and your brother, I have an older brother, don't owe me and your mother anything. You have given us more by being a presence in our life than we could ever possibly give to you. My mother actually disagrees with that rather vigorously. I work my fingers to the bone, both of you. You owe and big, you owe me big. Both are wrong and both are right. And that's who I was arriving in Washington. Grabbing every credential I could, all those brass plaques, holding tight to them, trying to reserve and hold the asset of credit. Credit of achievement. Because I would need it in the battles ahead. And then I'm hugged by the Downs boy. And Owen says, just your voice. And beauty lies within. And I'm a mess, in a good way. You can be a mess in a good way, I find. When this is occurring, a mess, I travel across town. In our town of Washington, D.C., which is our version of Johannesburg. I live in the little Fertile Crescent where, you know, my loved ones here, Sue Ellen and the gang live. My son goes to Sidwell Friends eventually. It's that little Fertile Crescent where the lawyers and the lobbyists and the journalists who can afford a house in that neighborhood live. Three quarters of the town is off limits. I cross the border. Are there connections between what I'm doing in my day life, in sunlight, and what's happening at night in the house? Of course. Do I recognize them? No.
I go to the worst high school I can find in America. It happens to be in Washington, D.C. I stand there in the hallways. I see the procession of kids walking by. 16-year-olds who can't imagine what 19 looks like. In a neighborhood, mind you, where 71% of the men between 18 and 36 are in the system. I mean criminal justice system. And sitting there in the hallway, I say, is there some place deep down, some invisible closed door where I think they are somehow less graced than me and mine? From my lily-white suburban high school, many of us off to fine colleges, maybe? Do I maybe think that? Those kids come to my side of town. You stare at them long enough to look away. What are they doing here? People stare at them like they stare at my son. Long enough to look away. And of course, they're part of the discard pile too. Big one. I was being forced to see things that were invisible to me by the thing I would least want. Fast forward. He's 6 and a half. Cornelia's working round the clock, morning, noon, and night. She was a journalist like me. She had all sorts of notions of what might happen, things she might do. All that stopped the minute we met the Ice Queen. And 24/7, Cornelia is there with him. She says, I have my job, you have yours. Now, interestingly, I met a doctor around this period who was another Jewish guy who talked straight to me. He actually was from Brooklyn, believe it or not. And he said, so, you seem like a nice young fella. What do you do for a living? I said, I'm a newspaper reporter. He's like, oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. This is an autism guy, specialist. I'm like, why? You good with numbers? You know, Mets and Mets. Private equity, nice way to go. I'm like, what are you talking about? Well, you're paying me $150 for this hour. And you got four of me a week, right? I'm like, yeah. Oh, got it. I can't just be a good journalist or a very good journalist. I've got to go and cut new ground because Cornelia's got to be with him all the time. And she is. And at 6 and a half, he's made little bits of headway. Three-word sentences. I want juice. Where's my car? This is from more hours of work than can be counted. Therapists, speech therapists, language therapists of every type, play therapists, a psychologist, a tutor. I mean, we are gushing money. We are in debt up to our gills. And the whole family is in this little upside-down world together. Now, part of what this book is about is not autism, bigger than autism, bigger than all the specific ins and outs of the narrative. It's about story. It's about the way we use stories to shape our lives, often unrecognized. There's no place at the adult table for that understanding of the way we shape our lives through stories, not only who we are and our identity, but our place in the world and the instantaneity with which we do it. Right now you're shaping a story. I shaped one on the way in, we'll shape one on the way out. Owen, of course, we're finding, is living within stories of his own construct. Still not something we can see, but that's part of what this is about. How stories become us, and we become our stories. So there's a story we told about Walter, his older brother. The story we wanted to tell ourselves. Now, Walter, like a sibling of a disabled person, is of a classic mold by six or seven.
a junior adult, able to handle anything the world throws at him. I got no issues. I'm good. 5 years old, his first day at a new school, we drive Walter, Cornelia and Owen, and Walter in the car. I'm somewhere, God knows where. And all of a sudden, 5 blocks from the school, Lafayette School in Northwest Washington, Walter's like, you can leave me here. I'm good. I'll just walk from here. Cornelia's like, this is in Dickens. They know you have parents. He's like, no, I'm good. Out he goes. This becomes part of our narrative about Walter. Well, that's Walt. Doesn't even need mom to bring him in on the first day. And now he's riding his bike to school every day, about a mile, even in the winter. Yeah, it's like a Jewish Marine. Go figure. That's the story we tell ourselves. And it is a key corollary. Handle anything the world sends at him, but he will never leave his little brother behind. Those two things. So we don't even really notice that Walter, cool, ready, ever able, gets a little emotional on one day of the year, his birthday. Seems to be an oddity against pattern. Who cares? So on his ninth birthday, Walter gets a little emotional in the backyard. The kids have left. We're bringing the plates and the cups. Owen follows us into the kitchen, looks at us rather intently, just frozen, standing there. And then you see like something's bubbling up. And he goes, Walter doesn't want to grow up like Mowgli or Peter Pan. And off he goes. This is his first sentence. And of course, Cornelia and I are stunned. It's like a lightning bolt went through the kitchen. And then we can't stop talking. What was that? I mean, that's what we said for 4 hours. We went, after 4 hours of that, Cornelia looks at me, as a wife will sometimes look at a husband, and say, okay. Look, you know, I'm with him like every minute, you know. I'm up at 3 a.m. because he doesn't sleep. I haven't slept in 4 years now. So, like, you're kind of the kooky guy here. You do voices, you wear the propeller hat, okay? Get up there, find a way back in. Okay. Now, a wife asks us of a husband, this is a moment where I have to lift the back of the Volkswagen. I'm like, got it. I have no idea what I'm going to do. But I crawl up the steps to Owen's lair up on the third floor of the house. Owen's on the bed, flipping through a Disney book. We have everything possible that Disney makes. We've taken out a second mortgage for Disney crap. And he's flipping them. He can't read, of course, but he likes the pictures. He's on the bed, and I'm there lying on the carpeted steps going, okay, what do I do here? What do I do? And as I get to the top of the steps, I'm there kind of with the top step like on my chin, and I look over, and I see a puppet. And it's a puppet I know Owen likes. It's Iago from Aladdin. You know this character. This is Gilbert Gottfried. And we have the $98 plush toy puppet, you know, up to the elbow. And the puppet is here and there, and I'm here. Grab the puppet. Okay. Let's try something. I crawl across the rug. Now, I don't want Owen to look up at me. He's not going to probably look anyway, but I don't want to chance it. I want him to just keep doing what he's doing. I pull the bedspread gently off the bed. I throw it over my head. All of this takes about 4.5 minutes. And then I crawl a little further, and I push the puppet up through the crease in the bedspread. And Owen turns, and I talk to him as Iago. Now, anyone can do Gilbert Gottfried's voice. It's like a broken Cuisinart.
So I say, Owen, how does it feel to be you?
Owen turns to the puppet like he's bumping into an old friend. And he says, not good. I have no friends, and I'm lonely. Now I bite down hard under the bedspread, and I say, stay in character. What would Yago see next?
Okay. When did you and I become such good friends?
When I watched Aladdin, you made me laugh. And that's when. This is our first discussion. It's Owen and Yago. And this goes on for about 2 minutes. At which point, I'm trying to think, Yago next. What would he say next? And then I hear Owen do something like, he's like clearing his throat, like something is coming, different. And I hear him go,
I love the way your foul little mind works.
That's Jafar. This is the next line in the dialogue. This is where we crack the code. He seems to have memorized dozens of these movies. If you threw him a line, he'd throw you the next line back. I mean, you could go on for hours. So we became animated characters. That's what we did. We came playing out scenes every night. We called them the basement sessions. Jungle Book was first. I'm Baloo. It's not quite typecasting, you know, but I'm kind of goofy. Cornelius Bagheera, the panther, protective, that works. Walter's King Louie, and Owen, of course, is Mowgli, and we play out scenes. You throw him a line, he throws you back the next one. You'd make one great bear. Oh, come on, Papa Bear. Exact. And it's not just the voice, he seems to be selling the emotion, too. And that's what we do for years. We become animated characters. This is how Owen gets his speech back. It's what happened. Not that other things weren't tried, and not that other things weren't helpful. But he learns to read by reading the credits. His phraseology moves along the lines of the dialogue. He's rewinding by the frame to get the way the mouth moves. And that becomes our life. You know, by day, I'm interviewing presidents. And at night, I'm meditating on myth and the emergence of the hero with Owen. We were living double lives. Quick twist, then we'll get to the finale. Owen went to a school called the Lab School of Washington, mostly for LD kids, learning disabled kids. There's a few autistic spectrum kids still in the mix. It was a reach for him, but he got in because at that point I'd won a Pulitzer Prize, and I would use that. Anything short of murder, I would do. So Sally Smith, the director of the school, and I mean, literally, I'm raising money, I'm calling people for the Learning Disabled Achiever Award every year, I'm camped in the basement, Cornelia is running everything at the school, just please let him stay at the school. Look, kids like Owen have trouble with change anyway, and this is his place. Until he's 11 years old and Sally Smith calls me in and says, it's not working anymore. I'm sorry. I'm like, you're sorry about what? You're sorry that you have denied your basic fundamental agreement with me that you will educate him? It doesn't work for him here. We can't teach him. We argue and then it's not worth it. She runs the school. I don't. And Owen has to go home. He's 11. We've been talking in voices for a couple of years. He's growing on his own path. And at this moment, we see he's really bruised. But he really can't tell us how he feels. He doesn't have enough speech. So he goes to the basement, our little cave of wonders. And that's where he stays Wants to be there a lot, like he's working on some project. Couple months pass. I see that a hallmark of people who are neurologically extreme, different. I do not say neurologically damaged. They are extreme versions of us. Owen's extreme expression, I see all of a sudden in front of me. Hyperfocus on Disney animated books where he is drawing the characters, almost like a Disney animator. It's like the two pencils. It's exact. And I grab the first book. First, I'm stunned. I'm like, he can't be tracing it. You can't trace. The paper's too thick. And I flip. They're all sidekicks. No heroes. He has become an aficionado of the sidekicks. At this moment, Cornelia realized that he has seen the world's judgment, felt it. We hoped he wouldn't see that for a long time, but now he knows. Other kids are racing forward. He's caught in the starting blocks. So he becomes an aficionado of the sidekicks. There are hundreds of them in Disney. Their job is to help the hero fulfill his destiny, as Owen will tell you. Some are goofy, some are resourceful, some are confused, some are wise. He starts giving sidekick identities to people in his school, many of them heavily burdened, the new school he had to go through, kids with heavy physical handicaps, some with no speech. But he's gentle, like a certain sidekick. And he's kind of funny, but you don't realize it, but he's like another one. And at the end of that first sketchbook, two things are written in a scrawl. I am the protector of the sidekicks. Two, last page, no sidekick gets left behind. You know, during the holidays that follow the arrival of the sidekicks, you know, Father's Day, birthdays, Hanukkah, we get cards. And we are sidekicks in the cards. He draws us. Now, you know, Cornelia is Big Mama from Fox and the Hound. Anyone see that one here, Fox and the Hound? Yeah, not a big one for Disney, yeah. But Owen loves it. She's the wisest and gentlest of the lady sidekicks. And I, in a good year, I'm Merlin. I'm very happy with Merlin. Or Rafiki from The Lion King, also very big. I'm delighted. Now, when I'm being investigated around this time by the Bush administration, I don't know if you remember, but they claimed I had stolen classified documents, and it's a little kerfuffle. you know, and we don't think Owen's really noticing what's going on. You know, I mean, just a little aside. So Paul O'Neill was a Treasury Secretary. He was my main guy for the price of loyalty. It was 2004 when George Bush was still kind of riding high, still doing that, you know, understand I'm the decider. You know, he still was big. He still was riding on the flow of 9/11. And O'Neill, the Treasury Secretary, goes, he's a blind man in a room full of deaf people. I'm like, okay, can we talk more? And he says, okay. And then I get 19,000 documents. Well, a year passes, and the book comes out in 2004. And the day after the book comes out, I'm on 60 Minutes, and Cornelia's in the kitchen. And she gets a call from Jeffrey Rush, the Inspector General of the Treasury Department. He says, hi, on behalf of other Inspectors General, I want to say that your husband is under federal investigation. And we're going to send some people by to seize some documents in an office he has behind your house. Cornelia says, I've never heard of Ron Suskind. I'm not married. And Cornelia, it takes Cornelia about 7 or 8 seconds to summon an already seasoned ferocity. Now, okay, she hates when I say this, but she's not here, so I'm gonna just go forward. When I'm challenged, I generally, as a Jew, my response is neurosis and self-blame. She's Irish. She goes right back at you. This is how these people survived on that rocky coast for 1,000 years. Excuse me, Mr. Rush, is that your name? Yeah. In case you haven't checked, my husband is a journalist. Yeah, right. He's protected by the First Amendment, so no one's coming to my house to seize anything. So after this whack, you know. She says, but if you give me your phone number, I'm sure I can get him to call you back. I actually know where he is right now, which you don't. And she calls me, and we begin a process of several years being under federal investigation. Now, I don't think Owen recognizes this until Father's Day that year, when he gives me my card, and I am Long John Silver from Treasure Planet. I'm like, honey, yeah, you're kind of a pirate now, right? I said, I guess. But with a heart of gold. Yeah, yes. Tell your mother. The only one who is drawn as a hero is his brother, who is actually the protector of the sidekicks. So after a few years of this crazy life, of us living within a kind of ecosystem of myth and fable and legend. Mind you, based on the hand Owen is dealt, he had to live on a diet of myth, fable, and legend almost exclusively. What kind of a person does that create? But we did too as a family. And after years of this, Owen's 14, Walter is 17, and Owen is going on one night at the dinner table about the return of traditional hand-drawn animation. Of course, that's what he does. Later he tells us, well, I can only feel with my fingers, which is why I find characters in all the books, we've got them stacked to the ceiling, who have the emotion I want to feel, and then I draw the face and I can feel it. And that's what all the old animators, Ollie and Wolfgang Reitherman and all those old animators did. You gotta feel it to draw it right. And so what they put mirrors on their desks in Disney way back so they can make the face to draw it just so. They had to feel it to do it. He loves that. And so he wants traditional hand-drawn animation to come back. It's over. We say, oh, and it will, don't worry. You betcha. Walter's looking at us like, who are these parents? He's like, Owen, listen. They put out 2 computer animated movies a week now since Toy Story. It's not coming back. Look, you're the only one who cares this much about the hand-drawn. You know, most people just, they can't care like you do. So he sees Owen kind of with a deflated look. Then Owen says, okay, but hold on a minute. Look, if you want hand-drawn animation to come back, you got to lead the charge. You got to step up. Now, we never challenge Owen in this way. Not the parental units, forget it. We're there to support. Everything's fine. Anything he does, we celebrate. Walter's challenging him. The only hero in the house, mind you. You want it to come back, you got to lead the charge. I mean, you've been thinking about these movies, breathing them, talking them since you're a little peanut. You got any movies in there? Any ideas? Come on. We're at the dinner table. It's silent. Owen gets that funny, bubbly look, like he did with, you know, Mowgli and Peter Pan at 6.5. The same look. Like he's going way deep. And he goes, I do have an idea. Everyone shut up. He's going to do it. Okay. 12 sidekicks searching for a hero. And in their journey and in the obstacles they face, each finds the hero within themselves. That's Owen's movie. Disney is interested in this movie these days, mind you. It's about a boy about Owen's age. He gives him an identity. Timothy, is it just an avatar for Owen? He writes it at the end of the book. About 3 years old, he says, well, a storm comes up from the horizon. The boy is scared. He runs from the house, gets lost in the storm, and can't find his way back home. He crosses a bridge that collapses behind him, and he finds himself in a forest, the land of the lost sidekicks. I said, why are they lost? He says, their heroes have already fulfilled their destiny. They have no purpose. So they just tell stories of adventures past, of what was, and try to find the qualities of the hero within each other. Though they are ever sidekicks, you don't get redrawn in this life. You are ever thus. In the story, the boy is taken in among them, a sidekick he, among the sidekicks. And off they go on a journey. The sidekicks come in various varieties because they're broken into categories. Again, powerful acuities. For a kid who gets measured at 75 on his IQ, my God, how you could affix a number like IQ on this population, it's criminal. But that gives everyone the excuse. Give them a broom, let them sweep. Be happy. He's created an emotional language out of 40 Disney animated movies, better than anything I've seen, and now has created an entire narrative construct. In the story, they face villains that match every one of the challenges he faces in his life. Every stage of it. And after the third one faces them down, they cannot defeat this one. They search on a journey for salvation. Timothy says to Merlin, Merlin, you must listen to me and Abigail. That's his current girlfriend, Emily. He calls her Abigail in the story. We remember too many moments, he says to Merlin. Every moment, too many. But as we cross them time and again, you see, we're searching for clues to who we are. So we think that the answers may be there in this powerful memory. Now, Merlin, if you could go back to your first moment of creation, maybe you can see something that can save us. And Merlin does. And the moment of creation, in the casting of a spell, Merlin sees himself on a table. He sees a mirror. And in the reflection, Merlin says as he comes back, in the reflection, I see the face of my creator. It's the mirror. And he tells the sidekicks of this enormous tale of search and find. And they say together, if we can find our creators, find that mirror, maybe we can be redrawn as heroes. And then we will triumph. You'll have to read the rest of the story. So we get to present tense, and it's a nice present tense. Owen just finished a 3-year college program on Cape Cod in Sandwich at Riverview School. He gets there, the first thing he does is start Disney Club. He wanted friends. He wanted to meet people like him. Cornelia and I, at this point, are in Harvard Square. We moved up from Washington, and I'm the writer in residence at the Kennedy School, but we're kind of giving him some distance. It's nice we're just an hour away, but this is his time to break free of us.
In theory, at least, right? You know, laughing, a knowing laugh over there. So we say, how's Disney Club going? Great. What are you doing? We eat popcorn and watch movies. I'm like, okay, you're the president of a club. He's never even been in a club, but now he's the president. You got to do stuff. You got to have activities, you know? Like 8 calls like that. Nothing's happened. So come spring of the first year, he says, okay, I talked to the teacher and we can have parent advisors. So if you and mom want to come, you can come. So we needed a little encouragement. We jump in the car. We race down to the Cape. There are 12 kids in the room just like Owen. The first movie they're watching on this day in April, Dumbo. A great movie, a great selection. Now, of course, we've been working, Cornelia and I, for years. We have PhDs in Dumbo. Owen works the remote. That's the prerogatives of the president. He jumps through 5 major moments in Dumbo, and then they stop and discuss. And that's at our behest. Do the most important parts. Just don't sit, watch the movie. What are they? They're this one. Okay, that's what you do as president. Got it. And as soon as we see this unfolding, we see kids who have not been raised in a crazy house where we develop this Disney therapy. Some of them had behavioral treatments. Some of them were just told, cut off the movies, because that's what people said for years. Whatever the affinity is, the intense, narrow, deep passion, it's perseverative, it's obsession. Cut it off. It doesn't work. Many of these kids had to live in a kind of, you know, attraction-repulsion maze with the affinity. Oh, I can't, I'm not supposed to watch. Oh, the voices are in my head. And all of a sudden, at Disney Club, it's like they're free. We're like, no, you're right. Everything's in there. None of them have ever heard of Joseph Campbell. Doesn't matter. They've imputed Campbell. It's all in the myth, fables, and legends we've been telling ourselves for 10,000 years. Every culture has a Beauty and the Beast. The Indonesians have a Snow White. These kids get that. We're like, come on. Okay, you, Dumbo. Why Dumbo? It's a girl. She's looking at us kind of startled. Well, because I didn't talk when I was little. And Dumbo doesn't talk. We find out later that many of the non-speaking kids bond with non-speaking characters who express all of the emotions, the full range, without words. Okay, and then what? Well, he was an outcast because of what made him different. And that was hard. And I know about that. But then he learned that the thing that made him different helped him soar. It was his best thing. And I say, okay, everyone, what are your hidden ears? Those ears that we can't see. And the girl sitting next to her says, I'm trusting and vulnerable, and it makes my life hard, but I'm great with rescue dogs. And anyone's injured, I know what to do. Good. Around we go. There's a kid sitting over there, and he's looking a little befuddled. Now, I've heard about this kid coming in. They say, this kid, his name is Josh, and one of the dorm counselors during the break says, I don't know about him being here. He's got no emotional core you can reach, and he's got some behavioral problems. I don't think this is going to work. I said, let him stay for the rest of the meeting. He's very much like the dreaded Rain Man character. The first thing I say to Josh, I say, Josh, can I ask you a question? Mr. Suskind and I want to ask you a question. I said, okay, let it rip. When's your birthday? I said, November 20th, 1959. His eyes flash. He says, that's a Friday. He's right. I had to check it on Google, but he's right. Mrs. Suskind, February 23rd, 1959. That's Monday.
It's okay, Josh, let me now ask you a question. Which character did you bond with first? Because they often will pick one, and it's a very careful selection, bespeaking identity. He says, Pinocchio. It's Pinocchio. Now, the dorm counselor, she's got a PhD. I don't know what she's thinking here. She says, is that because of issues of truth? Truth. These kids are chromosomally incapable of saying anything but the truth. And Josh looks at her, no. Okay. It's because I feel like a wooden boy, and I have always dreamed of feeling what real boys feel. And I was born, Mr. Suskind, with wooden eyes. And it is so hard to see, but I am able to a little now. You know, I dare anyone to find a neurotypical 18-year-old who can summon that well of personal insight using narrative. I have a neurotypical son. Walter would be the first to tell you, not even close. I couldn't do it. And that's what happens in Disney Club. Every week, Disney Club grows to 35 kids. Owen finished his 3-year tour as president a month and a half ago when he graduated. You know, there he finds a home. So now the Suskinds are, bumping into Temple Grandin as the famous autistic family, but in a nice and different way. And Temple said this apparently in a speech recently. He said, well, what's very enlivening, she said, about this book is that she is emotionally, as she says, unavailable. But she says, Owen and many like him are very emotionally sensitive. They have acuity, which many folks in the spectrum do. And that's kind of nice. That allows people a way in that I can't provide. And so that's a story of search and find, of a sidekick finding his inner hero. And that's really the story of all of us. Because after all, we are all sidekicks searching for our inner hero. So I'd like to actually introduce a hero tonight.
Hi, everybody. It's great to be here. Yep.
You know, we can do some Q&A now. I thought we'd do a couple minutes to get into some of the fun stuff.
Yeah.
Owen, of course, has great abilities here. Owen, would you have a seat? Or you can stand up here. Would you rather?
I'll stand up.
Okay, is this working? Hello, hello.
Yeah.
Okay, why don't I go with this one?
Just turn it on.
Well, it's making noise every time I turn it on, so I think this one will work better.
Okay, how's that?
That's good.
Okay.
Okay.
So I thought we would do a little Q&A. So why don't we ask some questions, and then Owen and I can tell you a few stories. Why don't you slide over a little, buddy? About this extraordinary journey. Owen?
Okay.
One of the things that we're doing a documentary these days, Roger Williams, a terrific Academy Award-winning documentarian, is following us around. You know, we're like, you know, we're the Jewish Kardashians. It's painful.
Yeah.
Owen is often mic'd, which is, you know. And so on the first day of filming, I was in the dorm with Owen, in his dorm at Riverview. This is before he graduated. This is in February. And Roger was asking Owen how he uses these characters, often, well, brilliantly, to manage his relationships. Now, Owen and I were kind of talking before that. It wasn't going very well because, you know, it was dad and son. And, you know, it was a little stilted. But Roger turns to Owen and he goes, well, I've used with my dad. I'm proud of my dad. And I've used some characters from The Lion King that yeah. have been helpful. And Owen does the voice at that moment. Owen, which voice did you do for Roger?
Okay. Simba, let me tell you something that my father told me. Look at the stars. The great kings of the past look down on us from those stars.
Really?
Yes. So whenever you feel alone, just remember that those kings will always be there to guide you, and so will I.
Now, when Owen is saying this, I'm thinking of him looking at the stars. And I'm feeling a welter of emotions. Now, remember, my dad died when I was a kid, and I often looked at the stars, thinking of him guiding me. And there will be a day when I am not here that I'm sure Owen will look to the stars and maybe tell others. But all of a sudden, he takes it a step further in this little interesting conversation where he talks about me sitting on the bed as Mufasa dying, right?
Yeah.
What do? You do another pass?
Okay.
Simba, you have forgotten me.
No, how could I?
You have forgotten who you are and so forgotten me. Look inside yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
Thanks, Dad.
And I say, who are you, Owen? And he says, I'm your son.
Yeah.
You know, the way these voices speak to and through Owen have really allowed us to go deeper into understanding of ourselves. Again, a great surprise. Shouldn't be, but is. And there are many voices that we use together because, I mean, in inhabiting certain characters, I mean, I'm often Merlin, of course. And so Owen... so Owen, you know, often can do both voices. But he'll do Merlin, and he'll do Arthur from really one of our favorites, which is Sword in the Stone. It's a great parent-child movie.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It is.
So why don't you do, when Owen was down often in the dumps,
yeah.
I would come to him as Merlin, and Owen would turn to me as Arthur. And Owen actually can do both voices better than me.
Yeah.
So one of the passages I think we did a lot was that one where Arthur is really down in the dumps.
Yeah.
Which is that one?
I can do it.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm sorry, lad. I'm sorry. I spoiled everything. I know that trip to London meant a great deal to you.
Oh, it's not your fault. I shouldn't have popped off. Now I'm really done for.
No, you've been a great spot. You can't go down, you know, be going from up from here.
I'd like to know how.
Use your head. An education, lad.
What good'll that do?
We'll get it first, and who knows? Are you willing to try?
Well, what have I got to lose?
That's the spirit. We'll start tomorrow. We'll show them, won't we, boy?
We sure will.
Yeah. Oh, many hours with that one. And really one that Owen used in a way as inspiration. You know, it's interesting that to tap these stories is like singing a song. I think we all do it. I think we all walk about with characters tucked within us. And of course, Owen has taught us that. as to how we tap these deep, deep wells of narrative inspiration when we are most beset. So that's been our life. How about some questions?
What does Disney think of this?
What does Disney think of all this?
Of what?
Of the book and you.
It feels great.
Disney is very excited, but they're a little conflicted. Because this has been very good for Disney. But, you know, it's a big, complicated, and let's just say a company that draws very strong emotions from every direction. So there's a disclaimer in the front of the book that I wrote saying several things. One is that I had to go to Disney Publishing because my agent, Andrew Wiley, explained to me, Ron, you've got a legal problem. I said, what's that? You can't go to any of your traditional publishers. I said, why? Simon & Schuster, Random House, why? Well, every word your son speaks is licensed by a multinational company. You'll be paying licensing fees on every page. I'm like, oh, Jesus. Yes. So I've got to go to a division of Disney, precisely. So when I go to the division of Disney, I say, they're like, wow, we're delighted you're here. What do you, I say, no, it's complicated. It's the licensing. Oh, great. So we're the only bidder. That's right. We're delighted. I'm sure you are. And then, hold on a second, and then I said, but we'll have a quid pro quo here. Look, I'll do it for you, but I need to say at the front of the book several things. One, that you in no way tampered with this copy. Because here I'm assessing your core line of business, these movies. Fine. They said, well, on our score, we will say that we are not recommending people watch our movies as any therapy for autism. Fine. I'll say that. And that's the disclaimer at the front of the book. Now, since the book came out, a warm wave has crossed Disney. They're feeling a little, you know, surprised and, giddy and uncomfortable at the same time. So we are in nice conversations with them on balance. There was, about 2 months ago, a celebration of Owen at the Disney Animation Studios, where he drew with the four greatest living animators.
Yeah.
And it was quite a moment.
Yeah, there we go, thanks. Thank you, Dad.
Okay, so let's ask another question. Yes, we have a friend of Owen's here named Will, who is a kindred of Owen, also with profound talents based on his compensatory muscles.
Don't go away yet.
No, don't go away yet, go ahead, Will.
Have you ever considered reaching out to any of those groups?
Yeah. So Will's asking, there are many aficionados of Disney who do their own artwork, who use and create and expand the stories, who find lessons in them. And as people in Disney Club often say, their sites say Disney's not just for kids. You bet. There are many sites that Owen regularly trolls. There has not been an official alliance built at this point between some of those groups around Owen, but they do contact us. So right now we're still in the swirl of book tour, but I imagine when things settle come fall, there probably will be more of that. One thing I will say though, is the final Disney Club happened a month and a half ago, and five kids in Disney Club who were graduating stood up and said, where I'm going next, I will be starting a Disney Club for myself.
Yeah.
Okay, another question. Yes, here, just hang on for a minute.
Yes, there was.
Okay, Owen uses the songs as much as the dialogue. And one of the songs he used when challenged is one that Merlin sings. There are many songs, but this is a nice one. Do that. Tell him, sing that one for him. Nothing Ventured. That's a kind of nice song.
Okay. Left and right, like day and night. That's what makes the world go round. In and out, thin and stout. That's what makes the world go round. For every up, there is a down. For every square, there's a round there, yeah. And for every high, there's a low
there's a low. And for every two, there's a fro. Fro, yes, fro. To and fro. Stop and go. That's what makes the world go round. In and out. Thin and stout. That rule it, I saw on a bug. That's not
That's yet. Arthur, by the way.
You. The main thing is you must set your sights upon the height. Don't be a mediocrity. Mediocrity, that's right. Don't just wait and trust to think and say that's how it's meant to be. It's up to you how far you go. If you don't try, you never know. And so my land, as I've exclaimed, nothing ventured, nothing gained.
Okay, how about one last question? We're at 9 o'clock. Yes.
I wonder if the 24/7 lady is here.
The 24/7 lady?
Your wife.
The 24/7 lady is managing the move of our family from a place in Cambridge to a new place. That? 1 second, we're gonna finish in a second. And this is another moment where I think the Nobel Committee has a family prize. So Cornelia, I think, is on the short list now for an extraordinary effort in lifting Owen forward. You want to finish up?
Can I?
Well, how about this? Why don't we do one last voice?
One last voice.
You want to, what do you want to do? You want to do love business?
Yeah, the love business.
Okay, okay, right. Okay, tell them what this is from.
Sword in the Stone also.
Okay, it's a good one.
I'll do it. You know, boy, that love business is a powerful thing. Greater than gravity? Why, yes, oh boy, that's right. Well, I'd say it's the greatest force on earth.
Say something.
And love has brought me to all you. Thank you for coming tonight.
Can I get back?
All right, you're fine.